And I salute all those watching from around the globe. We wish you a very incredible resurrection day. And I pray that it will not be a celebration of today, but a celebration forever. Amen. He rose so you can have a good life.
Hallelujah.
He rose that you can have abundant life.
Hallelujah.
He rose that you can have a successful life.
Hallelujah.
He rose that you can prosper and have good success.
Amen.
He rose that you can be healed.
Amen.
And always be healthy.
Hallelujah.
We bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. So Matthew chapter 27, from the first verse. When the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. To put him to death. Say amen. Father, we thank you for this incredible day. We bless your holy name for your anointing. Amen. So they killed him, hoping that they could stop the work of God. And in the process of killing him, they had to make sure that in their own minds that this man's death would stop him from ever living again. In verse 62 to 66 of Matthew 27, the Bible says, now the next day after they killed him and after his, which is the day of the resurrection, the chief priests and the Pharisees came together, so this was Saturday. He died on Friday. Is that right? He died. Now the next day that followed, the day of the preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that deceiver, they called Jesus a deceiver, said, while he was yet alive, after 3 days, I will rise again. Let's go. I need some speed, please. Okay. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead. So the last error shall be worse than the first. So here they do agree that they made a first error. In the midst of all that they were doing, they said that the second error would be worse than the first one. So they were not too sure about what they were doing. Otherwise, they wouldn't have been wanting to cover up and secure their motive by increasing the security over the tomb. Pilate said unto them, you have a watch. Go your way. Make it as sure as you can. In other words, secure the tomb with any adhesive, every adhesive you can get. Use any nail, any rivet. Go and weld it. Do whatever you want. Make it as sure as you can, which means apply the most advanced technology you have to shut the tomb. For sure. Say for sure. The next verse, it says, so they went under the command of Pilate and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the tomb and setting a watch. So not only did they use their most current technology to seal the tomb, they had living guards and watchmen and at this point, gladiators to watch over the tomb, well armed with absolute governmental approval. In the end of the Sabbath, so these guys must have been there 24 plus hours. And at the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, which is a few hours ago, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. Is there any Mary in the house? And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. So all of their technology and all of their security failed. They had their opportunity to seal the tomb to prevent the Messiah from coming out. An angel appeared from heaven, arrived, and the earth quaked. Anytime I see that word, earthquake, in the study of Jesus, what hits my spirit was and is that it wasn't just a little portion of Jerusalem, the whole earth. You are talking about the Messiah, the one who made the earth with his word. All mountains, Mount Rainier, the Drakensberg, the Himalayas, they all had their tremor. The earth shook. Say hallelujah, somebody. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. Made it look so easy. And made all the technology look like it didn't happen at all. His countenance was like lightning. And watch this. It wasn't just that his countenance was bright, but lightning. We all know when lightning strikes, it looks like a moving light. Looks like light in a velocity, in a speed. So the angel's face must have been glittering with moving lights, lightning. That will make an angel look like he's in for business. His countenance as lightning, which means it was a consistent release of sharp lights. And his raiment as white as snow. And for the fear of the keepers, did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that you seek Jesus, which was crucified. Say hallelujah, somebody. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come, see where the Lord lay, and go quickly. Underline that phrase, go quickly, if you have a Bible. Those watching around the globe, underline that phrase, go quickly. And tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goes before you into Galilee. There shall you see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre, and fear and great joy. And did run to bring his disciples word. So you can imagine these ladies who saw what they were not expecting to see. Began to run in the fear, yet with joy. Now this was the account of Matthew. Let's look at the account of Mark. Mark 16. From verse 4 to 7 and to 8, because of time. Mark 16, from verse 4. And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. It was a big stone. The Amplified calls it a big boulder. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. And he said unto them, be not affrighted. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold, the place where they laid him. But go your way. Tell his disciples and Peter that he goes before you into Galilee. There shall you see him as he has said unto you. Say hallelujah, somebody. Verse 8. Read with me. Let's go. And they went out quickly. One more time. And they went out quickly. One more time. And they went out and fled from the sepulchre, for they trembled and were amazed. Neither said they anything to any man, for they were afraid. Matthew said that the angel said, go quickly. And they went quickly. Mark says, for they went out quickly. See, hallelujah, somebody. But Jesus is a quickening spirit. We shall come there. Hallelujah, somebody. Look at the Luke account, please. Luke 24, verse 1 to 5. Luke 24, verse 1 to 5. Now, upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? Why seek ye the living among the dead? The next verse, it says, he is not here, but he is risen. Amen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee. Say hallelujah. Look at verse 11 to 12. The Bible says that, and their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. So when these ladies came to the apostles and told them what had happened, what they had experienced, and what they saw, they thought it was some ladies who were just sharing some idle tales. And because their belief system had been so obscured by the fear, and what had happened was way above logical thinking, logical imagination, in its most stretched out thinking processes. Nobody could fathom that this could happen so quickly, so real, so virtually, so vividly, so tangibly, that even the ladies came to talk about it. These disciples were in so much awe and fear for these 3 days, seeing what they saw. They were with him in Gethsemane when he was arrested. They saw the furious military command that took him away from their faces. The Bible says some of the disciples fled. All of them fled away. They ran. They ran. One of them is believed ran so fearful that his clothes fell off his body. And he ran home naked with fear. I mean, in those days, if the Pharisees and the Roman soldiers were after you, those guys had no mercy. Nobody had enough guts to fight for Jesus. Because the pressure of the moment, the event of the moment, the purpose of the moment was so divine, was so eternal, that no flesh, no blood could handle the pressure. He was carrying our iniquities, past, present, and future. He was carrying our sins, past, present, and future. He was carrying our errors, past, present, and future. And he was carrying our transgressions, past, present, and future. The weight of the trouble was too much. You know, sometimes in our natural ways, when there seems to be a sudden trouble, we all feel that there are very hot butterflies in your spirit, you know, in your belly. You just feel, you know, my belly is about to break loose for fear. You can imagine. Over 1,000 times more than that. Say hallelujah, somebody. So with that at the backdrop of their minds, they were processing what the women were saying based on what they were experiencing and what they had experienced. And because of that fear, they all ran to hide somewhere, hoping the Pharisees and the high priests and the chief priests wouldn't find them. These guys were hiding away for their own lives. 3 days later, they had barely recovered from this phobia. Now comes some women, 6 o'clock in the morning, bounding at the door, at their gates. Say, he is risen. He is risen. He is risen. I can imagine those guys. You say what? You say what? I'm sure Bartholomew and others went into the deeper room. Just Peter, you go check this out. Look at verse 12. Listen to this message attentively. I believe you've never heard a message like this. Then arose Peter and ran unto the sepulchre. And stooping down, he beheld the linen clothes laid by themselves and departed, wondering in himself at that which had come to pass. He knew about that linen cloth. He had the evidence that that was what was used to cover. But it was folded so nicely. And I'm sure he looked around to see if there were any evidences of foul play. No. He walked back, possibly like this, in this posture. If the past 3 days was days of trouble, this is beyond our thinking. Are you listening? I guarantee you, you've never heard a message like this one. Say amen. Look at the John account. We've seen the Matthew account. We've seen the Mark account. We've seen the Luke account. Let's look at the John account. So John chapter 20 from verse 1, please. John 20. Say hallelujah. Verse 1. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early when it was yet dark. When it was yet dark. So you can tell that possibly he resurrected between 3 a.m. and 5 a.m. Around that time, I just have a feeling it was around 3 a.m. Based on scriptural patterns. Say hallelujah, somebody. I feel so. I was asking the Lord yesterday. I said, Lord, what time did you get up? I did. I said, Lord, what time did you get out of the grave? I think he told me something. I don't know, but I have a feeling. You know, these past few days, I have gone through quite a bit, you know. On Thursday, I do believe that God was coming to take me home. I was quite sure about that on Thursday. And my spirit was going through. And at one time, when I could feel that the chariots of heaven were coming down, I tried to resist them. To kind of bind them a little bit. Say, Lord, my time is not, I'm not done. I'm yet to begin my job. And God showed me something that put me in my place. Just when my spirit was about to just pray and say, Lord, to try to stop him from coming to take me away, heaven came strong on me and said, this is beyond your pay grade. Your grace for intercession to turn things around is not in this one. when I choose to come and take you home, you have no power. I had that sensing with a split second. So I said, Lord, yeah. So I began to ask God, so what about this? What about these intercessions? And what about that? What about this? What about these things I've been praying for? And this and that and that. And my mind began to go over everywhere. The church, who handled it? Grace Foundation, who handled Grace Foundation? The business forum. What about my brother Sebastian? And then Daniel and then Edward and then the factory. Then all these things were going through my mind. And I knew that God was coming to take me home. And I was telling God, God, you know, when I come there, I'll be very glad, but I'll not be very happy because I know I've not finished my job. That same day, you know, three different people had the same word. I got a text right in that morning that someone was in prayer and saw these chariots of angels coming from heaven. And so he was praying, Lord, send for your chariots to come and help Emmanuel. And then suddenly he had a shock of his life when the angels told him that we are not coming to help him, we are coming to take him away. But he changed from that kind of intercession and began to plead for mercy. Then I had another text that Emmanuel, I don't know what's going on, but I just saw a vision of you laying on the floor of your house, lifeless. And I've been trying to intercede, but I don't seem to have the grace to pray you through. And this text came within 45 minutes in between thereabouts. Well, I knew something was up. This was the day Christ was to be arrested, you see, on the earth. You know, hypothetically speaking, time frame zones kind of stuff. Then I had another phone call. This person hardly calls me. And he called, and then I didn't pick it up. He called, because when I'm praying, I don't take calls. He called. So I text him back. I said, what's up? He said, I need to talk to you. And he said, well, I was supposed to travel yesterday, but God stopped me from traveling. I need to talk to you. And I said, okay, I'm preaching tonight. And when I'm preaching, I don't see anybody, because it's just my personal covenant with God. And he said, he said this. He said, I don't want you to die. I want to see you. Oh. It's no laughing issue, I'm telling you. And I said, Lord, okay. So I managed to see him just before I preached. But he told me his story. That he just knew that any time he could get a call that I just passed away. He said, Emmanuel, I didn't sleep the whole night. And we talked. Well, this thing continued through the process until yesterday. And yesterday, in my study and prayer, I was amazed when God told me my job description when I got to heaven. That I wasn't just coming to heaven for vacation. And they told me what I was going to be doing when I got to heaven. I can't go any further, but I'm telling you this. In my spirit, I know something is up on this earth. In my spirit, I want to tell everybody at the sound of my voice, anybody under my covering or connection, relationship, partnership globally, live your life as a Christian as if that day is your last day. And if there's anything that matters at all, that reason why you were called, your responsibility in the house of God should not be delinquent. In my study yesterday, as I was preparing for the message, I had a strange feeling to call one of my sons in Africa. That would have been around 5 a.m. their time. And I hardly called him, so I called him. And he picked the call. He calls me Daddy. He said, Daddy, I knew you were going to call me today. God spoke to me to expect your call. I wasn't sleeping. I wasn't going to sleep until your call came. And I said, what is it? He said, God showed me a vision of a large congregation of men of God on the earth. And each one was given an account of all their job. And he said, I saw some of the greatest men of God. And they all had files. And you were there. And he said, you took me along to that meeting. It was above my pay grade, but I was there with you because I was your son. And he spoke to me and told me what God showed him. And I told him what happened. He said, I wouldn't have been surprised if I had a phone call that God had taken you home. Well, my point is, why did I go through what I went through in the time of the Passover like this? I leave that to your spiritual intelligence. But if there's anything I want you to understand, be careful how you handle your walk. Be careful how you handle your responsibility in the house of God. Be careful how you handle what hands have been laid upon you to fulfill. Don't joke with it. There's nothing more important than that. Because when we get to heaven, it's going to be your calling. Not how much money you've made. So last night I had a very quick meeting with some of our young guys. And I told them, you know what? The things have shifted. Things have changed. I need you all to get on board. And I'm going to be racing with you, training you, preparing you, releasing you to go into your roles and go and plant churches and go and build churches and let's get the job done because what I've sensed and what I've seen and what I know, it could happen any day. Don't be surprised. I'm going to be speaking to the elders. I'll show out some of our pastors, those I can trust, that I'll tell them a few things that in case God takes me home, what you should do with the church, with Grace Foundations, with everything. I will prepare my ground. I will write my will and get ready. See, I'm listening. Now, back to this message. You will see why I said all this because it ties in very well. The first day of the week comes Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark unto the sepulchre, and see the stone taken away from the sepulchre. The Bible says that then she runs and comes to Simon Peter and to the other disciple, which was John, whom Jesus loved, and said unto them, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him. Peter therefore went forth and that other disciple and came to the sepulchre. See the sepulchre. The Bible says that, so they ran together, both, and the other disciple did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulchre. He stooped down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying, yet went he not in. So watch this. Peter was the head of the church. He was the bishop of the church, of the universal church. So he was, let's put him, the arch-apostle, you know, the bigger one among all the 12. But he was going there with John, who was, let's say, a younger apostle, just for hypothetically speaking. But the younger one was able to outrun Peter and got to the entrance of the sepulchre first. But he wouldn't go in. He was just there and waited for Peter to come and lead. So here you see leadership and respect for authority. In the entrance of the tomb, the guy said, the Bible said he was able to see, but he had to wait for the elder Peter. See, I get it. One of the things the body of Christ would have to begin to understand very clearly is the responsibility and the leadership structure as God ordains it. See, I'm listening. Verse 6. Then comes Simon Peter, following him, and went into the sepulchre and sees the linen clothes lie and the napkin that was about his head. Not lying, with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. So they come into the sepulcher, and they saw the linen clothes and the napkin well folded and properly, deliberately line up wonderfully. So to let you know that there was no foul play here. This wasn't an accident that someone came in and dragged the body away and do something crazy. It was so well put together to convince him that this thing is real. Say hallelujah, somebody. Say hallelujah, somebody. Look at someone and say, it is real. Now listen, the death, the burial, the resurrection. We have heard so much about these 3 days of events. But one word which the Lord put into my spirit this morning as I prayed was the word reset. Reset. R-E-S-E-T. Say reset. Now, what does it mean? Well, if for any reason maybe I leave Seattle and I go to Moscow, Moscow is about 12 hours ahead of me. So I set my clock to Moscow time. Then I fly back to Seattle. I have to reset my clock back to the original state because Seattle is my home. The subject of Christ coming to die on the cross and rise again was God's most glorious reset plan. And listen very attentively. When Adam lost the grace and put it into the hands of the devil, the world went back into the state in which we see in Genesis chapter 1 verse 2, when Lucifer fell from heaven. Let's read it. Genesis chapter 1 verse 2. See, reset. One more time. And the earth was without form and void. And darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of the Lord moved upon the face of the waters. Look at the Amplified, please. It says that, and the earth was without form and empty waste, and darkness was upon the face of the very great deep. So this was what happened when Lucifer fell upon the earth. See, I hear you. When Adam lost the grace and Lucifer again took back creation, he pulled creation back into emptiness, waste, darkness, void. So that which God had redeemed the earth from, the Lucifer put it back in there. So naturally speaking, you could see mountains, you could see trees, you could see human beings, but man was back into empty waste, darkness, void. Say hallelujah, somebody. For Christ to come and die, to pay the ultimate price, going down to Hades to fight this battle and take from the hands of the devil the keys of hell and death. When he rose again this morning, God reset the world. Say hallelujah, somebody. God reset. Things were brought back to the original state. Now, the definition of reset is, number one, to set again. God set things back into order again. So when he rose, it was big deal. Everything that went backwards fell back into place again. The mountains received their responsibility, their liberty, the birds. The Bible says all creation groaned against their will. Romans 8 verse 22. Romans 8 verse 22. Say, I'm listening. Can I hear some amen? Now we know For we know that the whole creation groans and travails in pain together until now. See, until now. And not only they, but ourselves also. So the entire human race and all creation have been brought back into that which God redeemed the earth from. And Christ rose again to put things back into alignment. The second definition of reset is fix in a new and a different way. Fix in a new and in a different way. The third definition I have is to become set again. So if these two originally were set here and something happened and it fell, when you pick it back, it's be what? Set again. So when he rose up from the grave, things which had fallen were all set again. So when he rose, everything rose with him. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Say, I am set again. Say, my mind is set again. Say, my soul is set again. Say, my spirit is set again. Say, my life is set again. Say, I am a new creation. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I am set again. One more time. Say it again. Say it again. Say, set again. Give somebody a high five. Say, I am set again. It means that we have been fixed back. Oh, hallelujah, somebody. I said, we have been fixed back. I said, we have been brought back. Oh, man. Tell somebody, this is big deal. This is big deal. Now, let's go back to John chapter 20. Let's finish this message. See, I am with you, man of God. Mm-hmm. Yeah. John 20. Let's read from verse 11. Now, so here, these disciples, John and Peter, saw the linen clothes well put together, folded nicely, and they were pondering, What exactly had happened? How do we explain this thing? What if the Roman government came and took away this body to put it on us, to kill us all? You can imagine how many things might have been going through their minds. So they went home. But the Bible says Mary, she wouldn't go home. Is there any Mary in the house? If I, there are some top believers on the earth called Mary. Say hallelujah, somebody. She wouldn't go home. No. I hate to say this, but I love to say it. Sometimes guys need some Marys in their lives. Sometimes guys are a little too pessimistic. So God give us ladies who are optimistic. But in this case, it was beyond pessimism and optimism. This was a woman whose sins had been washed away, a woman out of which seven demons came out. A woman who was in the wrong way of life and now has found salvation. This was beyond pessimism. It was beyond optimism. It was above every other mism. It was an issue of gratitude and love. You see, if you love God, You will stay in his presence until you find solutions. Not the kind of lifestyle we have this day where if God doesn't show up, then, you know, I'll see God next time. I hang around God for just 5 minutes, and if things go well, I am in church. If things don't go well, I curse at the church. Not that kind of thing. This kind of ding-dong Christianity must end. It ended right there. Amen. Say hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah. Say hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah. I mean, how many of you would really love friends who will speak well of you only when things are going well? Such people are dangerous, guys. Not trustworthy. Mary stood by hook or crook. When it was good for Jesus, she was there. When he's in the grave, I must be there too. That's consistency. That's real love. She wouldn't go home. Boy, she was weeping. Americans say she was bawling, but I disagree. She was weeping. She was weeping. She was weeping. When a woman is weeping under this kind of circumstance, it must be some serious one. Wailing. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulcher. And she will weep and look into the sepulcher. She will weep and look into the sepulcher. And she will cover her face and weep and weep and weep and weep and look into the sepulcher. Verse 12, please. The Bible says, and then she saw two angels in white sitting, and one on the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And they said unto her, woman, why weepest thou? As if they didn't know why she was weeping. She said unto them, oh, because they have taken away my Lord. And I know not where they have laid him. I mean, that must be some, you see, love makes you brave. I said, love makes you brave. See, hallelujah, somebody. Love makes you stick to the command. Stick to the passion. She said, and when she had said this, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing and knew not that it was Jesus. Well, the angels she couldn't attack, but she saw somebody who was flesh and blood, literally. Verse 15, please. And Jesus said to her, woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She's supposing him to be the gardener. Said unto him, Sir, if it's you who has taken my Lord from this place, tell me where you've led him. And I will go and take him away. What a daring spirit she had on Resurrection Day. The guys went home. You know, some of the things some of us have gone through, we can tell the shallow from the deep, you see. You don't need to give me too many examples. May every member of this church be deep in God. Amen. May you be trustworthy. See, I'm listening to you. She turned herself and said unto him, Rabboni, which is to say what? Master. Well, I'm shifting my message from research to master. She said, Master. What is a master? Who is a master? A man who has it all put together. A man who is an expert. So we finish your high school, you get to the university, you get your bachelor's, then you're going for your master's degree, which is specializing in a specific field. Jesus, by raising from the dead, he had his master. Because every other religious leader had died and never rose again. Boy, the guy broke through mastery. The guy came through martyrdom. Oh, I don't know about you, but I feel like preaching, but something is upon me to just go through this thing. She said, Master. And I will call him Master. Because he mastered death. He mastered pain. He mastered reproach. He mastered shame. And yet was still consistent. My goodness. I wish I can have some friends like that who have mastered challenges that could be trusted in the next level. So you see, the days are coming on this earth where people are not going to follow you because of the anointing or because you have a good word, but because you have some mastery in the things of God. Because success is not what you have achieved, but success is what you have overcome. He overcame the grave. So I can trust him. Say Hosanna, somebody. Say hallelujah, somebody. Say hallelujah, somebody. Look at someone and say, can I trust you? When she saw the angels, she didn't say master. When she saw the gardener, she was going after him. Give me back the body. But when he saw Jesus, she said, Master. You know, our Savior is a master. He can handle anything. So you can trust him. In all your circumstances, my Savior is my master. My shepherd is my master. My friend is my master. Jesus is my master. The Messiah is a master. Say hallelujah, somebody. He can preserve you from plane crash. He can stop your boat from sinking in the water. On the farm, he can stop you from being destroyed. On the battlefield, he is there with you. In domestic things, he's there with you. On the industrial part, he's there with you. It doesn't matter what crisis, he is the master. Say master. Say master. Say master. He's a master businessman. He's a master Messiah. He's a master preacher. He's a master Jesus. He's a master redeemer. He's a master savior. He's a master word of God. Say master. Say master. I celebrate the resurrection of a master. He is my master. Say Hosanna. Say Hosanna. Say Hosanna. Say Hosanna. He is risen. He is risen. He is risen. He is risen. Say hallelujah. Watch this. When they saw her, they sealed the tomb. So how the entire Roman Empire was behind this man's death. And she saw him come out in absolute perfection. What else could she have said? Rabboni, only you can do a thing like this. Only you can come through this thing and still be okay. So if our master went through it and was okay, I prophesy to you, you will be okay. Just believe in him. Just believe in him. Just believe in him. You can trust a master. Say Hosanna. Say Hosanna. In medical science, what general science cannot handle, what general medicine cannot handle, they call him the master physicians. Oh, I have one. He's called Jesus. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. I am almost done. And as I speak, the master is healing somebody's body. The master is giving somebody a new pancreas, a new kidney, a new liver, new eyeballs, a new business thinking life. a new family life. Say, the master is on my side. Look at verse 17, please. Read verse 17. Jesus said unto her, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say unto them, I, the Master, ascend unto my Father and your Father and to my God and your God. I would like to dissect this a little bit. Watch this. Jesus spoke these words to Mary Magdalene as if the earth was not under God, as if God had lost his fatherhood. Because God didn't lose his fatherhood. Neither did he lose his authority as God and as a sovereign deity over all creation. So naturally there was no need for Jesus to say that, because she knew that. From Genesis to Revelation, even Nimrod knew that this God was the master of all things. So why would Jesus Christ say again? In English, we may call it tautology, the repetition of something that has been said already. But the true point is that what he was saying has never been said before. What he was saying has never been realized before. Because listen to this, say, I'm listening. So Jesus came to reset all things as the master. What is the next phase? Say hallelujah, somebody. By saying this, he was presenting the synopsis of a new creation. And this is what I want to say. Let me help you. In the first 7 days of creation, the first day God spoke light. The second day he spoke the firmament. The third day he spoke seed. The fourth day he spoke light. The fifth day he filled the heavens with the birds, the firmament, and the waters with their fishes and the animals on the land. On the sixth day he made man. On the seventh day he rested. Watch this. Of all the first 6 days, all these things were made by words. Watch this. There is a philosophy of God's word which says that his word shall not be broken, neither shall his word return void. Is that right?
Yes.
Good. Now, what Adam did by obeying Satan and sliding all creation into the hands of Satan, he gave Satan the power to attempt to make void God's word. So Satan was now beginning to manhandle or mishandle deliberately every good thing God has set in order. He began to mishandle them to go negative so that he could make God's word void. So he brings deception. And he brought deception to Adam and Eve. Did God really say that thou shalt not eat of this tree? What he was trying to do, and which he did, he made God's word void in the life of Adam and Eve. Please keep your children under control, please. And so here, he attempted to make God's word void, and God's word became void. Adam lost his glory. And from that time, everything that was blessed by God became a curse. Are you listening? And I want to say this. Adam was the first Adam. Jesus is the last Adam. What Adam messed up, Jesus became the quickening spirit to reverse and to reset all things which were right but became void, were reset to become right again. And he is called the last Adam 1 Corinthians 15, verse 45. Let's look at that, because I need to learn with this word that what he came to do was to recreate creation again. So we are new creatures. Oh my God. Can I hear some amen? Can I hear some hallelujah? Can I hear some hosanna? Say the master. And as it is written, the first Adam was made a living soul. Based on Genesis 2 verse 7. And then the last Adam was made a quickening spirit. What was he quickening? He was quickening that which was right, but was made void. And he was bringing it back to the original state to set things again in proper place. It was like man was set to be in God's presence. But Lucifer dethroned man out of God's presence. Now God came to place man through Christ again back into God's presence. So the void, which we see in Genesis chapter 1 verse 2, that the earth became void. So the devil tried to make everything void. So when God blesses you, he tries to void the blessing. Now Jesus, the last Adam, Jesus, the quickening spirit, when he rose from the dead, he did not only come to reset all things, but he changed the code so that it will never again be located to bring it back. It's one thing closing the door. It's another thing closing it and locking it. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. So our salvation has been sealed. But oh my God. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Read verse 45 and then verse 17. King James and Amplified. Can I hear some amen?
Amen.
And those who are watching from around the world, the Lord has set you apart again. And he has put you back in the reset mode. And now we are about to see that not only did he put you there, but he's about to make you a new creation. In a brand new way.
Amen.
Let's read. And so it is written, the first Adam was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. Look at verse 17. Verse 17. It says, and if Christ be not raised, our faith is vain. And you are yet in your sins. Which means the only alternative God had to reset all things and to bring them into brand new creation processes was for him to die. But the death was not complete if there was no resurrection. So the raising of the dead was a seal. And he locked it in the raising dimension. And nobody else would ever go through that, die, and rise up again. Oh, say hallelujah, somebody. Say hallelujah, somebody. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 17. It says that Second Corinthians 5, verse 17. Therefore, if any man be, there's it. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a what? A new creature. All things are passed away. Because all things have become. So now you see that things have been what? Reset. But not only did he reset all things, he brought them to another dimension that could never be corrupted again. That that Satan at his best still could not be able to decode that one. Because this one, God took it out of the garden into the tomb. The encounter between Lucifer and Adam was in the garden. But the encounter between the second Adam and Lucifer was in the tomb. From the cross into the tomb. On the second day in the tomb, he went to the headquarters of Satan. This time, I believe, not as the Lamb of God, but as the Lion of God. So I can imagine Lucifer saying, "We killed the lamb, we killed the sheep." In fact, he was bleating on the cross in their mockery. The next day, he arrived in hell, not bleating, but roaring. Say hallelujah, somebody. So there was a transfiguration right there. When Lucifer attacked Adam and Eve, they couldn't be transfigured. But as for Jesus, there was a transfiguration in the warfare. And when he came out, he virtually recreated creation. We are not just a resurrected being, but a new creature. Look at the Amplified. Say amen. Therefore, if any person is engrafted in Christ, the Messiah, he's a new what? Creation. A new creature altogether.
Amen.
So here, Christ became too complex to be handled. So the resurrection is a real big deal. It's a major, major, major move of God, for which cause all creation should celebrate and give thanks. Not shallow thanks, not shallow appreciation, but in the depth of your bowels, knowing for sure what he has done for you. He is a new creation, a new creature altogether. The old, previous moral and spiritual condition is passed away. Behold, the fresh and the new has come. Now, look at what Hebrews says. Hebrews 10, verse 20. Hebrews 10, verse 20. As I conclude the message. Are you blessed today?
Yes.
He says, by this fresh, new, and living way, which he initiated and dedicated and opened for us through the separating curtain, veil of the Holy of Holies, that is through his flesh. Look at the King James. The King James says that by a new and a living way, which he has consecrated us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. Watch this. So on the cross, through his body, he took away the old and brought in the new. And when his body tore into pieces by the torture on the cross, the veil also split open. That from now onwards, there is a new and a living way. So we have been reset. We are new creations. The whole world has become new in a new way. No more by the animal, by the blood of animals, shall sin be atoned for, but in the higher level that the blood of God, which the devil can handle. The devil could handle the blood of animals in some way because he could also counterfeit them. But the blood of God is a whole new strategy, a whole new key, far above the devil's pay grade. Say hallelujah, somebody. So when on the day he resurrected, it was big deal. And today, it's big deal. And Mary called him Master. Guess what? Only a master could do this thing in a new way. He did not just restore the old to reset, but completely new. It doesn't even look like how it was before. It's like God taking away your 1948 Chevy and giving you 2017 Chevy. It's all Chevy, but it's a whole new way. It's a whole new vehicle. Say hallelujah, somebody. Receive the anointing. Receive the redemption. Receive the blessing of the new creation in the new living way, in the new dimension. Say, I receive. Say, I receive. Say, I receive. This morning, I come to tell you that Christ rose again, and he has reset all things.
Hallelujah.
Guess what? Not only has he reset our lives, but our years, which the locusts have eaten. He has reset our time. He said, I will restore the years the locusts have eaten. I will restore the years the cankerworm have eaten. So not only our lives, but our time. So now I have time to finish my assignment because I have been reset. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. So what your grandfather couldn't do, because he died not saved, therefore, he didn't have time to do anything for God.
Wow.
Now that you are saved, you have redeemed your time.
Amen.
And God has redeemed you and restored your lost years.
Amen.
Now you have time. You have your reset to walk the walks of God.
Amen.
To work the works of God. And to be what you were created for.
Amen.
He is risen. He is risen. He is risen. Now, when I say he is risen, you shout reset. He is risen.
Reset.
He is risen.
Reset.
He is risen.
Reset.
He is risen.
Reset.
For the one more time, he is risen.
Reset.
Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Well, one more revelation. It means, therefore, say hallelujah, somebody. Every year that we celebrate the resurrection, I promise you, spiritual things have been reset again.
Amen.
You know, because that portal is open. And we can always tap into that time. That's why most people in the nations of the world, during this time, they are on a fast. It's a time of consecration. From last Sunday, when we entered into Jerusalem, the Palm Sunday, 6 days to his crucifixion. Six is the number of man. So God established that 6 days, that men could walk the 6 day journey of fasting and prayer, because on the next Sunday, on the eighth day, new beginning, we will have another opportunity to have our time reset. He is risen, 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 reset. One more time. He is risen. Receive the blessing. Receive the favor. Receive a new dimension. Receive a new anointing. Receive a new beginning. We bless the Lord. I said, we bless the Lord. I said, we bless the Lord. And those who are watching from around the globe, we declare that your life has been researched. God has researched your life. You are up again. You are above and above only. And no weapon formed against you shall prosper. You know what that means? I prophesy this one by revelation. That anytime the devil has a plan against you, against you, against you, against you, then we get to Easter and he dies and rises up again, the devil's plans expire. Say hallelujah. So you know what? If you go through any mess in life and the devil is after your case, you press the button of the blood of Jesus, it reset. I said, anytime you fall into sin and you repent, yet the devil puts guilt upon you, you press the button of the blood, it goes. Say Hosanna! Say Hosanna! Say Hosanna! Say Hosanna! Say Hosanna! Say reset! Say amen. Say reset. So somebody is sick and he's under curses, under reproach. You lay your hands upon him, you release the blood, reset. Say Hosanna! Say Hosanna! Say Hosanna! Say Hosanna! Mama. Then Lucifer came to Jesus on his 40-day fast. And the same trick he used for the first Adam, food and deception. And he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Because I am the reset. I don't bow to the devil's words, neither his tricks, nor his deceptions, nor his lies. I am God's reset button. The woman, Mary Magdalene, said, Master, surely he's a master. Where others failed, he succeeded. Where others fell short, he proceeded. Say hallelujah. The angel said, where are you looking for the living among the dead? He is the reset. I'm telling you, this morning when God spoke this word to me, my system went boah. He said, Emmanuel, your message today. And this is what he said. He said, your message to the whole world this morning. That's what he said. So I'm not just preaching to Sunshine Church. God told me that I'm speaking to the whole world. He said, your message to the whole world today is reset. America has come to a reset. Great Britain has come to a reset. Ghana has come to a reset. Spain has come to a reset. China has come to a reset. North Korea for sure has come to. Your marriage has come to a reset. Africa has come to a reset. North America has come to a reset. The Antarctica has come to a reset. Australia has come to a reset. New Zealand, a reset. India, a reset. You, a reset. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. May you stay in this revelation. Stay under this covering. Don't let anything intimidate you. The blood of Jesus is a reset button. When I see the blood, I will pass over. When I see the blood, I will pass over. When I see the blood, I will pass over. Reset. He's alive. I say he's alive. I say he's alive. He is alive. He is alive. He is alive. Jesus 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 is alive. For Jesus came to take us to a new living way. In his body, a new living way. A new living way. I prophesy peace upon your spirit. And I speak to all the nations of the earth. Peace in the name of Jesus. All the continents of the earth receive this global message. Peace on all the seven continents of the earth. In the name of Jesus. But I see the blood flowing upon all the continents. Right now, right now. I'm not kidding. I see the blood flowing upon the continents. I see the blood. I see the blood. I see the blood. See the blood. See the blood. See the blood. The blood of Jesus. The earth receive the glory of the blood of Jesus. It's reset time. It is reset time. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I wish you an incredible new life from today. You know what I think? The resurrection day in the spirit is the first day of the year. That should have been the January 1st. The first day. It's that real. That in the realm of the spirit, it's a new calendar. From resurrection day to resurrection day. 1 year. See, I get it. Surely, goodness and message. Hold on, hold on. Close your eyes, everybody. At this point, it is important for you, everybody, to reset your life with God. And if you've never had the opportunity to meet Jesus as your personal Savior, as your Master, I am not talking about going to church. It doesn't matter whether you've been an elder. Going to church does not make you a Christian. As much as keeping your car in a garage does not make your car a garage. You have to give your life to Jesus so he can reset you. And if you feel that you've been saved before but you missed your tracks, he will reset you again this morning. And if you are that person, lift up your hand. I will pray with you. Either this is your first day or you want your life to be reset. Lift up your hands, all eyes closed. You know somehow you've missed it here and there, in your thoughts, in your ways. And those who are watching around the globe, God sees you. Just lift up your hands and pray after me. Lord Jesus, I repent for all my sins, but I receive forgiveness because of what you did on the cross. Let your blood wash away my sins. Remove the records. Remove the sin consciousness and give me a new life. I receive you, Christ, as my Lord and Savior. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thank you for restoring my life and resetting my spirit, soul, and body now and forevermore. Amen. Say amen. Well, if you've just prayed that prayer, believe that it's been done. You are born again. Welcome into the kingdom of God.